Peace and grace, good morning. It is good to be together in worship this morning. I am glad and grateful that God has called you to worship here at First Presbyterian Church of Allentown. Whether you are joining us in person or via the live stream, this is a place that we call home, and we worship our Creator together. So friends, let us give thanks for that. If you are a first-time visitor this day, we are excited that you are here. Found in the narthex there are visitor cards. This is an opportunity for you to fill out contact information for yourself. If you fill that out, leave it in one of the offering plates or give it to one of the ushers or greeters, and we will be in touch. We want to hear your story, and we want to share a part of our story with you. So again, if you are a first-time visitor, we are glad that God has called you here. We are glad that you are worshiping our Creator with us this morning, and we are excited to have more conversations with you. Before we begin worship this morning, we have a few announcements. The very first is I should probably introduce myself. My name is Taylor Hall. Some of you might not recognize me. And actually, that's not a joke because some of you have not recognized me. Yes, I have shaved my head, and I will tell you why as part of my sermon later today. But yes, I am here. I am Taylor Hall. I serve as one of the pastors. My colleague, the Reverend Stephen Emick, is away for vacation this week. Actually, yesterday was the funeral service for Stephen's father. I had the opportunity to attend that. It was a beautiful service. Many of you know that Stephen can preach a funeral sermon, and he did that for his dad, and it was a beautiful service. It was a true witness to the resurrection. And so we give thanks for Stephen's ministry and the ways in which he's cared for all of us. And again, we continue to care for him by allowing him to be away this weekend. But I can't do this alone, or at least I don't want to. So I am joined in worship leadership this morning by the Reverend Diane Caraha. Diane, many of you know Diane. She has been a longtime friend of this congregation. She is an ordained minister of Word and Sacrament in our denomination, the Presbyterian Church. Diane has been involved with many facets of our ministry, but specifically a lot to do with our mission work. And so, Diane, we give you thanks that you have joined us, and we give you thanks that you're helping lead worship this morning. Friends, would you please welcome Diane with me this morning? In between our two services, we had an all-church event. We've been trying to do one of these all-church events once a month. If you remember back in September, we had our homecoming. Just a few weeks ago, we had our chili cook-off. Today was an all-church faith formation opportunity, and our children, youth, and adults actually went around the building. You might have seen the footprints on the ground, to hear more about local food insufficiency. And there was opportunities to serve, to give, to learn more about all of the various ministries that we partner with across Lehigh Valley, specifically the ones that address food insufficiency. There is more information. Again, although some of you might have missed this all-church event, it was wonderful, so I'm sorry if you did miss it. There are still guides that we have, so if you want more information about some of the things that we did during this time, as well as about some of the information about some of the local organizations that we partner with, there are guides that will be found in the table right as you enter into the sanctuary, and again, an opportunity to learn more about the local food insufficiency. We also have the announcement of we are looking for nominations for our elders, deacons, and as well as those who will serve on the church nominating committee. So if you know of someone who you feel is called to be an elder or a deacon or even serve on the nominating committee, we ask that you submit those nominations. That includes if you yourself feel that you are called to be an elder or a deacon or serve on the nominating committee, please nominate yourself. We fully embrace that, value that, and welcome that. So again, if you know of somebody, including yourself, please send those nominations in. I believe those are all of the announcements that we have this day. Actually, we have one more right there, financial stewardship. If you have not contributed or submitted your financial pledge for 2023, please do so. This is utmost importance to our ministry because it allows us to prayerfully pray over and discern how are we going to move Christ beyond the walls here at First Presbyterian out into the greater community just as we are called to do. Your financial pledge helps us discern how we are called to use our funds for next year. So have a conversation with God, have it with yourself, have it with your family. Think of what you are able to give, and then please do so. Submit those pledges as soon as you are able, and again, we'll continue to give you more information as we continue to plan for next year. Now, I do know those are all of our announcements this morning. So friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship God together.
Good morning. My name is Ann Ferreira, and I'm an elder currently serving on session. Would you please join in the responsive call to worship? Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Our hope is in the name of the Lord, the healer of all that is wounded. Our trust is in the name of the Lord, the one we gather to worship and praise.
In faithful prayer, there is power to save the sick. Anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, let us confess our sins and pray for one another so that we may be healed. God, our strength and Savior, you know our great transgressions, our hidden faults, our secret sins. With our hands we grasp at power. With our feet we stumble into evil. With our eyes we look out for ourselves. Forgive us, gracious God, and lead us in your holy way of life and love and peace. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Though we wander from the truth, God brings us back and saves our souls from death. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Let us sing our thanksgiving.
Morning. I'm Sarah Tia Lakatosh. I'm a current member on session and elder. I'd like to invite you to join me in praying the prayer of illumination. Lord God, by the power of your Spirit, enlighten our eyes, instruct our minds, rejoice our hearts, and revive our souls so that our lips and our lives may bear witness to your word. Amen. This morning, let us hear God's word for us as it is found in the book of James in the 5th chapter, verses 13 through 20. Are any among you suffering? They should pray. Are any cheerful? They should sing songs of praise. Are any among you sick? They should call for the elders of the church and have them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. The prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up, and anyone who has committed sins will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective. Elijah was a human being like us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth yielded its harvest. My brothers and sisters, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and is brought back by another, you should know that whoever brings back a sinner from wandering will save the sinner's soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. This is the word of the Lord.
I invite our younger people to come up and join me up here on the rug. Good morning. I'm so glad you could join me. And your name is? Kathy. Hi, Kathy. I'm Diane. Thanks for joining me. I have a question for you. How can you tell if somebody's having a tough time, like if they're sad or lonely or afraid? How can you tell? Usually their face is maybe in a frown or something, yeah. Any other things that come to mind? Like if they're sad, they might, yeah, like their body language might be a little droopy. Maybe they might be crying. Yeah, or they might even say, you know what, I'm really having a tough time. Yeah, any of those things. Do you know sometimes when people are having a tough time, especially little kids, but people of any age actually, sometimes they do hurtful things. They hurt others or themselves even, or even somebody's property because they're feeling bad. And so there's somebody has said that hurting people hurt other people or other things. So what can we do if somebody in our family or a friend or someone we know, somebody in our church family, what can we do or say to help somebody who's having a tough time? You can make them a card or give them a hug. Those are great ideas. Yeah. You know, I know of a little boy who, when his grandmother was having a difficult time, sat down next to her and held her hand. He didn't have to say or do anything else. He just was there for her. And you know, that's something that any of us can do, which is really good to know, because sometimes we don't know what to say or don't know what to do. But if we're there for them, then they know that we love them, and they know that God loves them. Sometimes God speaks through us, huh? Yeah. Well, thank you, Kathy. Let's pray, okay? Would you do that with me? Dear God, thank you for your love. And thank you for giving us other people to love and to be loved by them. God, help us to know what to do and say and be when someone's having a tough time. Thank you, God. Amen. Thank you, Kathy. Okay, have a good day.
Friends, we live in a world where suffering abounds. It's sometimes hard to see the light or the hope when faced with this harsh reality, but it is true. We live in a world where suffering abounds. The pandemic is still raging, and its impacts are still ongoing. There is war, famine, and forced displacement of citizens and refugees across our world. Natural tragedies such as hurricanes and tsunamis, tornadoes and earthquakes still rage on all creation. Here in Lehigh Valley and across our country and our world, children and families do not have access to food, shelter, or clothing. And I'm sure all of us can name someone who is currently experiencing disease, divorce, disaster, disappointment, desperation, or death. Maybe one of us ourselves is experiencing one of those. So yeah, we live in a world where suffering abounds. And if you are anything like me, and I think you are as disciples of Christ, maybe your constant thought or even prayer is, "Holy God, what am I to do amidst all of this suffering?" We are approaching the end of our fall series, Together, Building a Home with God. At this point, we've covered the majority of the marks of membership as found in our Presbyterian Church USA Book of Order. These marks of membership are things that are required of us to do as members and disciples of the Church of Jesus Christ. If anything, this series should have taught us that faith cannot be passive. To be a disciple of Christ, we are called to act and to do. Every mark of membership has started with an action verb. Demonstrate a new life. Study Scripture. Work in the world. Care for creation. Support the church. Proclaim the good news. Live responsibly. Even today's theme, just like all the others, is a call to action. Lift one another up in prayer, mutual concern, and active support. Faith in and of itself is a call to action. As disciples of Christ, we need an active faith to navigate, heal, and prosper as we live in this world, especially because of all of the suffering around us. Our scripture lesson today comes from the book of James. And James, as a book, is all about practical, down-to-earth, active Christianity. James, who some consider to be the younger brother of Jesus, was one of the first leaders of the early Christian church. What made James unique is James wasn't so concerned with deep theological truths or complex doctrines. James just wanted the followers of Christ to act, to do something with their faith. Specifically, James looked at what he called the royal law, James taught his congregation how to live out Jesus' words of love your neighbor as yourself. Some of James' most notable teachings come from chapter 2, where he strongly states that faith must be active and that faith is based off of one's works. James is the one who taught us that faith without works is dead, and one is justified by works and not by faith alone. Now, while some of us like the deep theological truths or the complex doctrines, I do, while some of us like those, sometimes all we really need is the down-to-earth, practical, day-to-day wisdom as found in the book of James. Especially when we ask ourselves the question, what am I to do amidst all of this suffering? At the end of James' letter, the passage that we heard from today, it specifically addresses that question. James chapter 5, the end of his letter, the end of this book, talks about caring for the sick and the suffering. And when James is talking about the sick and the suffering, he is not just talking about strangers on the streets, but he is talking about the sick and suffering found right here within our own community of faith. James calls us to care for the neighbors right here next to you, the people who are sitting next to you in the pews, to your left and to your right, in front of you and behind you. Every congregation, including our own, has numerous people who are sick and suffering. I think that number is actually higher than any of us would suspect. We live in a society where even the best-intentioned people feel drawn to be superior over one another, and to be honest with our own sufferings or to share our vulnerabilities with one another is perceived as an act of weakness. That is true for me, and it is one of my own greatest struggles. But if we cannot name our sufferings with one another, what is even the purpose of being a church? What is the point of calling each other neighbors and friends if we cannot trust each other with the hardships that each of us experience? What is the point of belonging to a community of faith if we cannot extend and receive compassion and healing from people who are suffering just like us? And that is why we turn to the book of James. He reminds us that every church must be a healing community. We must care for the sick and the suffering. We are to pray for them / us. We are to anoint them / us. We are to confess and forgive them / us. We are to bring them / us who have wandered away back to this community to receive compassion and healing once more. And if we do not care for one another, especially when people are at their lowest, or even when they are least deserving of our love, then we have failed the very call to discipleship as a Christian community. Think of Jesus. He came to live among us to do three great things: to teach, to preach, and to heal. And these three are woven together. Think of some of his teachings. Jesus said that he was the bread of life because he fed thousands who were hungry. Jesus said he was the light of the world because he healed a man who was born blind. Jesus said that he was the resurrection and the life because he raised Lazarus from the dead. You cannot separate teaching and preaching and healing from one another, and Jesus instructed his disciples, us, to also be teachers and preachers and healers. And we can be. We have the power to be. Because all of us are made in the image of God, and because God is our ultimate healer, we too all have roles as healers. Every one of us has a part to play. And it is the utmost importance that we each be a person of healing toward another in this congregation. Because if I am a healer to you in your suffering, you can be a healer to him in his suffering. And he can be a healer to her in her suffering. And she can be a healer to them in their suffering, and they can be a healer to me in my suffering. The cycle of healing that happens within a community of faith cannot be broken. It is infinite. That is the vision of the church that God has for us. And healing in a community, in this community, healing in a community is relational. Healing is the relation of mind, body, and spirit. It is found in our relationships with each other, and it is found in our relationship with God. Healing is also connected to prayer. Some of us have said or done some things that we have regretted, and we need to let go and forgive. Through prayer, God calls us to confess. Some of us are in trouble or experiencing some kind of difficulty. Through prayer, God calls us to intercede. And some of us are sick, and some of us are suffering. Through prayer, God calls us to heal and be healed. The word prayer is used 7 times in our passage today, and it is found throughout our entire Bible. Christians are supposed to be a people of prayer. That takes time, concentration, energy, and focus. And when prayer becomes an actual spiritual priority in our lives, it moves us beyond just words and into action. Now, as I said during the announcements, and as you all saw, you have noticed my recently shaved head. A few weeks ago, my cousin was diagnosed with stage 2 Hodgkin's lymphoma. My cousin is my age, and he has a newly born baby boy. My family is a small family. We only have 7 of us cousins, including me and my 2 brothers. Growing up, our families were inseparable. While we have gone our own ways in adulthood, that bond that we had as children will never be broken. My cousin's mom, my aunt, and my godmother, when she called to tell me of his diagnosis, she asked for my prayers. And of course, I would add my cousin to my prayers. I would also add his family, my family, our family, to my prayers. My uncle, who is also my cousin's uncle, organized a fundraiser. $50 would be donated for every person who shaves their head. So that's what we all did. All of us in our family, plus many others, we shaved our heads to show support and to raise money. And in the last couple of weeks, as I've been praying for my cousin and my family, I have talked more with my cousin, my aunt, my uncle, and my whole extended family in the last couple of weeks than I have done this entire year. Because I've learned that when you pray for people daily, you also want to be in conversation with those people daily. You want to chat with them. You want to check in with them and see how they are doing. Truly, at the core of your being, you want to be in relationship with them. And you want to extend your care and your compassion, and you want to provide whatever support you can and whatever support they need. and you do so. That is practical, down-to-earth, active Christianity. So what are we to do amidst all of this suffering in our world? We must live an active faith. We must pray daily. We must show concern, compassion, and care. And we must provide support as needed. We must heal and be healed. And we must trust in a community that receives our own suffering with open arms and loving hearts. We must love our neighbors as ourselves. So will you do that with me? Will you pray with me in this moment? Friends, join me in the Spirit. We confess to you, O God, that our lives are filled with sickness and suffering. We acknowledge that each of us are in need of your healing. Send your Holy Spirit to us and through us. Let us heal and be healed through the presence of Jesus Christ and in the presence of one another. May we live as your church, now and forevermore. Amen. This is the word of God given to us this day. Thanks be to God. Amen.
We gather at the table. We come from many places, differing in age, differing in race, differing in orientation, politics, and even religion.
As we come together around the table, we discover that our differences are not just something we tolerate, but that our differences are indeed a blessing. The more difference we bring, the more fully we experience the presence of the sacred in our midst.
So come, children of God, just as you are. Wherever you are on this journey of life, you are welcome here. Here in this place, here in this community, here at this table. Come, children of God, come and remember that God is with us.
Friends, I invite you to join with me in the responsive prayer of great thanksgiving as printed on the screen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
With Isaiah the prophet, we give you thanks for the promise of your heavenly banquet, a feast of rich food and well-aged wine, for the strength of your steadfast love, destroying the shroud of sin and shame, for the gift of your saving grace, our long-awaited day of deliverance.
With Mary and Martha, we remember Jesus, his liberating word and healing touch, his saving death and life-giving resurrection, his promised return and glorious realm.
Lord Jesus, come in glory. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, O God, as we share this feast of bread and wine. Make us one in the body of Christ our Lord and one in the company of your saints.
With John the Divine, we look with hope for the coming of your new creation, a new heaven and a new earth, for an end to suffering and mourning, when every tear will be wiped away, for the fulfillment of your ancient promise on the day when you make all things new.
Oh, Holy God, we know that you know the prayers of our hearts and minds, but still We lift them up to you as an act of faith. We have prayer concerns across the world, across our country, and across our community of faith. In this moment of silence, we lift them up to you. Holy God, we celebrate sickness, or we pray for sickness and suffering. We celebrate anniversaries and birthdays. Oh God, you know our joys as well as our concerns, those that we have named and those that we are not able to name. We pray for everyone that we meet, that we encounter, our loved ones, our family, our friends, the strangers on the streets. We pray for those who have not been prayed for yet today. Through Christ, the Alpha and the Omega, in the communion of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, O God, now and forever. Hear us as we pray now the prayer you taught us by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, handed over to death, he gathered with his disciples, and he took the bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat. This is my body given for you. As often as you eat this, remember me.
In the same way, Jesus took the cup. He blessed it, and then he poured it out, saying, This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Take, drink, do this in remembrance of me. The Apostle Paul reminds us that as long as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we do proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes again. At this time, I'd like to invite the communion servers forward. We have been practicing receiving communion by coming forward. In a moment, I will invite all of you forward. The communion servers will rip off a piece of bread for you. You will then take a cup from the tray. You will eat the bread, drink from the cup, and then you can return the plastic into the baskets on either side. For those of you who need a gluten-free option, found on the lectern side or the choir side, in that basket are gluten-free options for those of you who need them. And for those of you who might have any difficulty coming forward, please stay in your seats. Diane and myself will walk around the sanctuary, and as we get near to you, please just raise your hand and we will serve you the elements there. In the Presbyterian Church, we practice an open table, which means that this table is open to everyone. If you confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you are welcome here. So friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
for the... Okay, sure.
Thank you.
Receive this bread. Feed on it with thanks. It is the gift of God to sustain and nurture. It is Jesus, incarnated and given for us. Give thanks.
Drink from this cup with thanks. It is the gift of God to bring us joy. It was a hard-won battle. It is Jesus poured out for our redemption. Give thanks.
We have been fed and nourished at this table. We give thanks to our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And now I invite you to think of how you may respond in love to those who are going through a difficult time, through whatever means that we have, ourselves, our time, our talents, our treasures. I invite you to stand and sing the doxology. Let us pray. Gracious God, for all your gifts, we give you thanks. We ask that we may use all that we are and have to your glory and to the care of those around us. These things we pray in your gracious name. Amen.
friends, we recognize that suffering is a part of each of our stories. But God has given us the strength and the power to address that suffering. We share our concerns with one another. We pray for one another. We heal one another. We love one another. So friends, let us do exactly that as we live out our faith in Christ. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of us this day till the end of all days. And all of God's people said together, Amen. Amen. Friends, go in peace.
Thank you.